Good morning and welcome to Capital Life Church. Hope you had a great Thanksgiving and are enjoying time with your family. We're going to have an awesome time of worship today.
For nice weather and early Christmas decorating.
I am thankful for Lisa and our family of faith.
I am thankful for family. Thank you for allowing us to partner with you to share the love of Jesus.
I am thankful for my health and the health of those around me.
Number one, Jesus Christ.
I am thankful for Jesus.
I am thankful for Jesus.
I am thankful for Jesus.
I am thankful for Jesus. Because of what he did on behalf of each of us.
I am thankful for Jesus.
I'm thankful for Jesus.
We are thankful.
Very thankful.
I am 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 thankful.
Coming, ooh.
so excited to announce that Eduarda and Charles had their baby girl, Ren Maria, who is so beautiful. Congratulations to them. I'm sure their Thanksgiving was extra special this year. And because of all of your generous giving, Capital Life Church has been able to bless over 140 families with Thanksgiving meals, hot meal sandwiches, turkey meals. So thank you for that. We have had so many people giving, either financially or with giving food, and we want to say thank you for that. And if you ever want to join us in handing out food or blessing people by actually being there in person, we could use a lot more hands. So you can email outreach@capitallife.org and volunteer. We would love to have you join us for those outreaches as well. And there will be an opportunity coming for you to be able to buy toys for children at Gleam Elementary who may not have a Christmas otherwise. And so be looking for the Christmas star. You can go to capitallife.org/outreach. And there you can find a family that you might be able to bless this Christmas with gifts. God bless you. Thank you so much.
In the morning I'll Orphans
About to give in the offering today, and I want to say thank you for those of you that have given toward the cameras. We're almost there. Let's finish that giving and we'll be able to pay off the cameras that will help us do so much more. And this coming Tuesday is Giving Tuesday, so as you're considering your end of the year giving, please go to capitallife.org/giving and you can give online on Giving Tuesday. But today we want to give in the offering. Remember, thanks is in the giving, and we want to give as thanksgiving to the Lord and as worship to Him. So I just want to pray for you as you're giving. You can go to capitallife.org/giving and give in the offering today. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for all that you have given to us. We have so much to be thankful for. And today we want to worship you in our tithes and our offerings. Bless each giver, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
God is good all the time, and I'm so glad that you are here and joining with us. You have been faithful. It's shown by the fact that you are watching right now. You have been faithful to God, And God is still very much in control, and God is watching over you and speaking to you, and I believe He'll speak through this message to you. So get ready. Be expectant in your faith. I'm starting a series on godly influence. And as you may remember, I spoke to influence in the realm of social media and being a good steward of our influence for the kingdom of God just a few weeks ago. And I want to continue with these thoughts with you, because there's a number of ways to look at influence and how to wield that influence towards eternal purposes. Now, there's a story, and it's a true historic story, and you may be aware of some of it. I want to share it with you right now, just outside of Boston. In April 18, actually, of 1775, there was a young stable boy, and he overheard a conversation between two British soldiers, and he heard them planning what was an attack. In fact, they said, tomorrow they're going to have hell to pay, talking about the townsmen. And so this stable boy ran to a silversmith by the name of Paul Revere, and he told him what he heard. And Paul Revere immediately took out towards the colonists. He wanted to mobilize them against this attack and help them to be prepared. And it's known as the famous midnight ride of Paul Revere. Well, it was actually at 10 p.m. It wasn't at midnight. But we have heard about this story since we were little kids. So now Paul Revere is going across the land telling people that the British are coming and that they're going to be attacking. And the towns and the villages ended up being prepared to defend their country. By the next morning, the Redcoats felt that they had a surprise attack, and they were coming in stealth manner, and they find that they meet the colonists, American patriots there in Lexington, who were prepared and ready. And the British were not prepared to meet opposition. They thought they were coming in a secretive fashion. And from that moment on, the Revolutionary War was on its way forward, was launching. So it's an interesting bit of trivia, something that you may not know, that Paul Revere was not the only one to go out and seek to tell the colonists what was happening and that there was an attack that was coming from the British. There was also a tanner by the name of William Dawes, and he also took a ride. He rode a similar horse. He went through routes that were somewhat similar to what Paul Revere took, new areas, but same type of territory that he covered. And he also took a ride, sharing that the British were coming. But he was so poor at mobilizing. I mean, he was so poor at conveying what he was conveying that historians have assumed, and they assumed for years, that he must have gone to territories that were British towns. But it isn't true. He didn't go to British towns. He was simply horrible at his ability to influence. He lacked that ability to mobilize people, even with a cause that they agreed with. So I want to speak to you as leaders, and I say that because Lisa and I knew when we moved out here with our family in 2000, the year 2001 in September. And when we moved out here, we knew that God would establish a work. Now, we didn't know exactly what that work would look like, but we knew that God would bring us together with influencers and that we would be able to influence for the kingdom of God, for the Lord Jesus Christ. And these influencers would take that influence and have the ripple effects everywhere they go. And we have seen that manifest before our eyes. A litmus test of Christian maturity is whether you are able to use the influence that you have for the kingdom of God, or whether that influence will simply go in directions that are all about you or all about me. And so Dale Carnegie had a best-selling book years back. It's still read today, How to Win Friends and Influence People. And it is a world bestseller. People are interested in the subject of how to influence people, but so often that interest is towards how to make money, how to be famous, how to get into elected office, or how to influence people and sway them in this way or that, but not necessarily towards what is eternal and about God and about the things that matter most. In Matthew, the 5th chapter, I want to read to you here, starting in the 13th verse, we see that these are words written in red. And I spoke these words back when I was speaking about influence as we steward well the realm of social media. But here are the words again. They are pivotal to what this series is all about. These are words spoken by Jesus. That's why they're in red in my Bible. They are spoken by Jesus, found in the book of Matthew. You are the salt of the earth, Jesus says. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden, neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. So, let your light shine before men and women. The Bible tells us, these are Jesus' words, so that the result will be that God is given praise. In other words, the kingdom of God is advancing. It's impacting the lives of individuals in your realm of influence. Let your light so shine. Let your light shine. And know that you are also the salt of the earth. Now, I talked about the salt being a preservative agent, that it would be packed upon meat in Bible days. They didn't have the refrigerators that we have today. And that would keep the meat fresh longer. So we talked about salt being a preservative. But salt also does something else. What else does salt do? Salt brings taste. In fact, all you need is a little bit of salt, and it greatly influences, changes the taste. The Bible says, taste and see that the Lord is good. And so we're seeking to give people a taste of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so salt cannot remain in the salt shaker. If you do that, the salt will never be able to mix with and therefore influence what it touches. And so we can't be a big salt warehouse, meaning the church, where we have all the salt and we hoard all the salt right here, and we don't let the salt touch what at present lacks that taste. And that is, again, taste and see that the Lord is good. And in the book of John, in the 8th chapter, in the 12th verse, the Bible says, I am, these are Jesus' words, I am the light of the world. And so Jesus is the light, and we, as ambassadors of the Lord Jesus Christ, we carry the light of Jesus. In other words, we reflect Jesus wherever we go. We dispel darkness wherever we go. We bring guidance into individuals' lives and into the lives of a group if we're speaking to them by speaking forth the Word of God, by representing Jesus well. We bring forth light. So you are salt and you are light. Now, if I were to ask you, one person who has truly impacted your life, touched your life, who's had the greatest influence on your life, it's doubtful that the response that you give me will be, well, it was this movie star I saw in a movie. And it's very doubtful that your response will be, it's this politician that was elected. Now, it doesn't mean that there isn't influence being wielded by such individuals. But when it comes right down to our own lives, do you know what the response is when I ask, who's the person who has influenced your life the most? And meaning outside of Jesus Christ right now, who is that person? You think for a moment. Who is that person in your life? And the most often repeated person is going to be a mom, a dad, a coach, and I like to put this one in, a pastor, might be a sibling, might be an aunt, an uncle, a grandparent. They entered into your story in a way that these others that have great fame did not. It became personal. And what did they do when they entered your story? They influenced you. And that influence has touched you to this day. It speaks to who you are. You can't really tell who you are without telling about this individual and this individual's impact in your life. And so that impact that is there, as it becomes very, very personal, it means that they entered your life and they added value to your life story. So we wouldn't mention somebody if they didn't add value. You could say, oh, it's not my mom, it's not my dad. I had a very difficult upbringing. Listen, the individual that you are thinking of right now and that you may have even said out loud who it is, that individual will have added value to your story. So in Esther, in the book of Esther, and of course we love the book of Esther, it's the saving of an entire people group in the midst of a great struggle, in the midst of a nation that could go either way, and a people group that could be annihilated. Let me read this to you, found in the fourth chapter of the book of Esther. The Bible says, when Mordecai learned of all that had been done, he tore his clothes, put on sackcloth and ashes, and went out into the city, wailing loudly and bitterly. But he went only as far as the king's gate, because no one clothed in sackcloth was allowed to enter in. In every province to which the edict and order of the king came, there was great mourning among the Jews, with fasting, weeping, and wailing. Many lay in sackcloth and ashes. The king has given an edict. It's not moving the way of God. It's a very difficult edict for the Hebrew people. Fourth verse, when Esther's eunuchs and female attendants came and told her about Mordecai, she was in great distress. She sent clothes for him to put on instead of sackcloth, but he would not accept them. Then Esther summoned Hathach, one of the king's eunuchs, assigned to attend her, and ordered him to find out what was troubling Mordecai and why. So Hathach went out to Mordecai in the open square of the city in front of the king's gate. Mordecai told him everything that had happened to him, including the exact amount of money Haman had promised to pay into a royal treasury for the destruction of the Jews. He also gave him a copy of the text of the edict for the annihilation, which had been published in Susa, to show to Esther and explain it to her. And he told him to instruct her to go into the king's presence to beg for mercy and plead with him for her people, for the Jews. Hathach went back and reported to Esther what Mordecai had said. Then she instructed him to say to Mordecai, all the king's officials and the people of the royal provinces know that for any man or woman who approaches the king in the inner court without being summoned, the king has but one law, that they be put to death unless the king extends the gold scepter to them and spares their lives. This is a matter of life and death for her to approach the king. But 30 days have passed since I was called to go to the king. When Esther's words were reported to Mordecai, so the king's not asking for her, Mordecai is saying, you go in and appeal, make an appeal to the king for your own people. And she's aware there's been no summons, so her life is in danger. Mordecai sent back the answer, Do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. But you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but, and this is that great scripture, but who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this. So Mordecai is saying God's going to take care of his will. But Esther, you're right here to do it. And if you don't do it, it'll be done by another. God will not be held back by your actions. But God wants to do this through you. And who knows but that you have been born for such a time as this. And for some of you, you have an Esther anointing upon you. You know that you've been called out to this area for such a time as this. Or you know that you've been called to your family. Or you know that you've been called to where you work. Or to a certain issue. Some work on issues of human rights. And they deal with things like sex trafficking. Listen, that God has brought you to be alive in the year 2020 for such a time as this. And then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai. Go gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my attendants will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish. Wow. She's saying, I'm going to do God's will no matter what. But I want you to fast. I want you to pray. And I want you to make certain that we have aligned the environment for God to fully move. Because this is dangerous stuff. And the 17th verse, so Mordecai went away and carried out all of Esther's instructions. One person influenced an entire people group's future. One person influenced a king. One person influenced what was an entire nation of people in a generation. What did she do? She addressed the king on this, and it made all the difference. What happened to Mordecai? What did he do? Well, he influenced the queen who influenced the king. Pretty interesting, isn't it? I go back to this idea that influence is rarely going to be from a situation where it's a large group of people. What we see in history is that more often than not, it's one individual who influences another individual, who has a ripple effect to influence other individuals. And so if you're saying, well, I'm not a famous person, neither was the person that you thought of that influenced you the most. And so you have that ability to influence the one who influences another, who influences another. And for some of you, you're raising a family, you're influencing children. And for some of you, you are influencing what are not your own blood children, but they are children in the spirit. In other words, God has given you a heart for them. He has mandated to you, and you know it by the spirit, that you're to influence that individual, and they're a child in the faith. And so there's influence, as some of you are doing as coaches and as working in the government or whatever it is that you may do, but you are influencing one after another. Mordecai influenced one who influenced one, and it saved the entire Jewish race in that generation. In Esther 2:7, the Bible says Mordecai was influential because he entered Esther's story and he added value. And that's what we're reading in that verse, is that he entered in and he added value. When God wanted to save the Israelites in Moses' day, he didn't speak to a nation. He spoke to one individual, and that individual is Moses. God impacts families. God impacts organizations and nations by influencing individuals. Now, Genesis, in the book of Genesis, the 13th chapter, starting in the 5th verse, the Bible says, now Lot, who was moving about with Abram, Lot was the nephew of Abraham, and here we see Abram is Abraham. So now Lot was moving about with Abram, also had flocks and herds and tents, but the land could not support them while they stayed together, for their possessions were so great that they were not able to stay together. In other words, they've been blessed. They're blessed. And quarreling arose between Abram's herders and Lot's herders. The Canaanites and Perizzites were also living in the land at that time. So let me put glasses on. I'll be able to see all this better. We're also living in the land at the time. So Abram said to Lot, let's not have any quarreling between you and me. He's trying to bring peace. Or between your herders and mine, for we are close relatives. Is not the whole land before you? Let's part company. If you go to the left, I'll go to the right. And if you go to the right, I'll go to the left. Lot looked around and saw that the whole plain of the Jordan towards Zoar was well watered, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt. So he sees, okay, if I get to choose, I see a real nice land over there. This was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. So Lot chose for himself the whole plain of the Jordan. In other words, Lot's going to choose the best as to what he sees in the natural, at least, and set out toward the east. The two men parted company. Abram lived in the land of Canaan, while Lot lived in the cities of the plain, and pitched his tents near Sodom. And another translation says that Lot leaned his tents towards Sodom. The Bible does not at this point say that Lot lives in Sodom. He's simply leaning his tents. He's going near enough to capture the sounds and the sights of the travelers going in and out and the smells of Sodom. He doesn't live there yet, but where you lean is where you will live. So I want to talk to you for a moment when I'm discussing influence and godly influence. I want to talk to you about your leanings, because you may say, I really am not fully down the road on that. I just, you know, I'm leaning into it a little bit here. I dabble in something. I sip of something. But where you lean is where you will live. And we see that it isn't long before Lot is living in Sodom. And he's there in Sodom that is just going so opposite of God. People don't regard God, and now here we see that he is there and brings his family into the land of Sodom. He simply leaned until he lived. Your influence is in direct relation to your leanings. So I want you to consider where you're leaning right now in life. Leanings, when nurtured, will grow. That's true of godly leanings. And thank God for those of you that are into the Word of God. You're reading the Word of God. You're listening right now. It's intentional that you be a part of this service. It's intentional that you're part of a family of faith at Capital Life Church. It's intentional how you wield your influence. All of that, I applaud you in that, because it's so vital that we see that leanings, when nurtured, will grow until they become steadfast, one way or the other. In the Old Testament, when Sodom was to be destroyed, Lot could not influence even members of his own family, meaning his sons-in-law. He could not influence them. So if you live in a certain way, if your leanings bring you in that way, you lack the ability then to have the type of influence to say, well, I say this, follow what I say, but don't follow what I do, because I'm living here myself. And so we see that members of his own family wouldn't even listen to him with what he had to say, with his concerns. If you desire to be a leader of great influence, I want to call you towards leaning into God right now. Lean into your devotional life. Lean into what is a life of worship. Put on worship wherever you go. My wife got me something that's a little speaker, just about this big. that I can have it and listen to it and put the any songs I want to hear to bring peace in the midst of a world that can cause anxiety. And you have the ability, just like I do, to just tap right into worship songs or to talk about God with people in the room. Talk about what God is doing and what He wants to do in the days ahead in our nation, in our world, with all the things that we know have happened over this past year and with all that we hope will happen in the years ahead, certainly in the weeks and months ahead in regard to world pandemic, in regard to the recent election, in regard to issues of race relations, so many things that we're bringing before God. We want to have influence, don't we? We want to be able to have influence to bring the hope and the purposes of God to bring them forward. So before he sat on the throne, if we think of David, who was a shepherd boy, what did he do? Because he wasn't always king. He leaned towards God even when he was out in the fields tending sheep. Or we can think of Joseph when he was just a teenager and he's receiving dreams from God. And when he's receiving those dreams, he'll see them manifest one day, but not before great struggle to try to wipe them out. But what is he doing in the fields when nobody else is watching? He's leaning into God, into the ways of God, into hearing from God, into interacting with God. And so if we want to live a life that's all about the temporal, we can do that, and most people do. Make it about our money and the paying of bills and getting to relax on the weekends and trying to get ahead in my job or whatever it may be. But if we want to lean into the things that will matter in centuries to come, it will be the things eternal. And if we want to impact our family towards blessing rather than curse, then we want to lead into the ways and the purposes of God. And we see Mary, who was just likely a teenager, when she is to bring forth the Savior, and we'll be celebrating Christmas before too long here, and the Savior coming into the world. Well, we see the same thing there, that she was leaning into God before an angel even comes on the scene. And so was Joseph, who had good character and integrity, and we'll go into those stories when we get closer to Christmas. But Jesus' purpose that we know is there in Scripture is to save the world. That means he was thinking of you and he was thinking of me as well. In other words, all who will seek him, he can be found. But to save the world, we know, what did he do? He drew together 12. And out of those, three were what were a core group of the 12. And it was an effective way in order to reach the world that he pared it all down to 12. Effective leaders develop people. And I want to ask the question, who is it that is in your life that you're helping to develop, that you're helping to bring forward in the ways of God? It's gone way past being just about you and just about me. We need this to be about everyone in our realm of influence. And wow, do you have a larger realm of influence when you think social media and so many other things that we now are a part of that our grandparents did not know. So this can touch the lives of others, but not without it being intentional. And that's why we need to be intentional in sharpening one another, intentional in our relationships, even in the midst of COVID, even in the midst of quarantine, considering how can I bless this person who is going through having COVID, or how can I be a strength and a blessing to someone who's discouraged right now, just doesn't know how to get up and out of the funk that they've been feeling. The Bible says in Hebrews, in the book of Hebrews, in the 10th chapter, starting with what is the 23rd verse, the Bible says, "Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on for toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." So we are to continue to assemble together. We are to encourage one another in the Lord and strengthen one another. And so John Maxwell gives 10 points, and I want to share them with you as we get ready to conclude here. How can I be influential in the life of another? Well, John Maxwell, the best-selling author and former pastor, by the way, says these things. Number one, people are insecure by nature. Give them confidence. Number two, people like to feel special. Honor them. Number three, people look for a better tomorrow. Give them hope. Number four, people need to be understood. Listen to them. Number five, people lack correction. Navigate for them. And I'll be talking more about that concept in this series, in the weeks ahead. Number six, people are needy. Speak to their needs first. Before you start talking all about your own, speak to their needs first. Number seven, people get emotionally low, especially in a pandemic. Encourage them. Who can you encourage today? And therefore, and thereby, wield influence for the kingdom. Number eight, people want to succeed. Help them win. Number nine, people desire relationship. Provide community for people. And we at Capital Life Church seek to do that with excellence. Number 10, people seek models to follow. And I'm not talking about supermodels. People seek models to follow. Be an example for them. And so in all of this that we see, we recognize that there are practical ways that we can wield influence for God. And I want to encourage you right now and just close with this message, with this thought, that you're being prayed for. That means supernatural activity is being stirred up in your life. Are you aware of that? We are praying for one another. I ask for your prayers. As the lead pastor of Capital Life Church, and with Lisa, as Pastor Lisa and the executive team and the pastoral team, we ask for your prayers. I ask that you pray for all of our leaders in the church, because they are leading areas where they are having impact in the lives of people. And as you pray for us and as we pray for you, the high water mark of the Holy Spirit is being lifted, and we're believing for that high water mark to be lifted in our nation and in our world. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for this message about influence, because it's really not about us, it's all about you. And we pray, Lord, that we might be effective to bring forth your purposes, your ways, your will on this earth. God, we pray for our nation, we pray for our world, we pray for peace. We pray, God, for great joy to return amidst all of the struggle of things of late and the battle of things of late. God, bring healing to our land. Father, I pray for each person who's listening, who needs to be in right standing with you. God, I pray that at this moment they'll receive Jesus as Savior and Lord, or return to Jesus to rededicate their hearts and lives. Having gone in other directions, I pray that there will be a great sense of running, God, in your direction. I pray this for each and every person who says right now in their hearts, yes, this is me. I need to rededicate my heart, or I'm giving my life to Jesus right now. Bring healing, bring hope. We pray these things in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
So much for joining us for service today. I wanted to remind you this holiday season that you truly do not have to be alone. If you want to find out more about what's happening here at Capital Life or get connected, please reach out to me. We also have counseling and pastoral care available. You can email me at julie@capitallife.org. Also wanted to invite you to CLC Connect, which is happening right now in our virtual foyer, opportunity to discuss the message as well as share prayer requests and pray together. Also, if you are new, it's a great way to meet some other people from Capital Life and find out more about what's happening here. Please join us next week and have a wonderful week.